Good evening, and welcome to Afro-Latinos and African-Americans Colloquium, ARAAC Explained. My name is Emily Guzman, and I am the Director of Diversity and Inclusion at North Carolina Central University. The mission of the Office of Diversity and Inclusion is to promote mutual understanding and collaboration among all university students, staff, and faculty, along with the broader community. Our current initiatives are to increase the programming involving Afro-Latino and Latino students. This is part of the university-wide strategic goal of increasing the percentage of Afro-Latino and Latino students. Tonight's program is a perfect example of that program. In addition to our initiative, our campus is one of the few HBCUs with an LGBTQIA resource center on campus. It was the first one at an HBCU in North Carolina, and our goal is to educate and create an increased inclusivity of LGBTQ populations throughout campus. Join us for our upcoming Transgender Awareness Week, November 14th through 18th. There will be events throughout campus. Along with these initiatives, our office has many ideas for the future, but we are definitely student-led and would like student feedback. My door is always open for your ideas for diversity and inclusion programming. For tonight's events, we have many amazing panelists that we'll soon introduce for our discussion. But first, I would like to welcome Robert Trowers and the Jazz Ensemble.
continuum jazz studies program at NCCU. And this is sort of a mixed brass ensemble. This is the full big band, but basically what we have are an amalgam of freshmen through grad students here. We have a African percussion instructor, yes, at Duke University, Mr. Bradley Simmons. We share a hometown, Brooklyn, New York. So thank you so much. We have
We need to move past trying to be accepted by a European standard and embrace our Africanness. And then once we do, we don't need to ask for that approval or that visibility to be recognized through their eyes, but recognize it through our own. People of African descent from Latin America are at the core of the development of Latin America. So there's no country in Latin America that doesn't have an African story. Does that need to be told? Yes. Does that story need to be shared more? Absolutely. But I think we are visible within ourselves, and that's where it needs to start. But we need to start from a place of Africa at the center, and then move out from there. I am a woman of African descent in Panama, in Boston where I live, wherever I have traveled. That doesn't go away. It's how we recognize that visibility and not seek the approval of others to validate who we already are.
I'm coming from Uruguay, that is South America, a small country. In the south of the south, the history books say we are a white country, we don't have black people. The same in Argentinian books. I grew up with that. So can you imagine reading in my country saying that we are a white country where there is no black people? So denied, we don't have indigenous, we don't have blacks, no, we are European descent. So when I was 18, I went to my first trip to Brazil, and voila, it was Africa to me. I was in a conference on African descendants, that I saw African descendants that, for me, started in Brazil. No here, no in the south where I was, in Brazil. It is amazing now, and for you or for American people, you have more clear the situation because you have born that you are black or you are white. The levels, the tag that you have from the beginning. It's not the same situation in all countries, particularly in mine. It doesn't mean that we don't have racism. That is a part of our racism. You know? For me, when I had the chance to work in an HBCU, was like a dream. We don't have an HBCU in Europe. Until now, I feel blessed to be here, to have a group of people with the interest in Afro-Latino, Afro-American, Afro-Diaspora, because it's part of who we are, that we try to bring a different perspective on what we teach. It's not only Spanish. Is Afro-Latino culture. Spanish is like a way through we communicate something that in our perspective is more important, that you need to know that we are not different. We are the same people, coming from the same history and dealing, overcoming pretty much the same obstacles.
But the one thing I did want to say as a former student here at NCCU is that what Yvette said is absolutely true. We are present, we exist, our contributions are, they need, they are real and they need to be validated by us. But also in sort of thinking about the comment that was made in the film, in the video, that Afro-Latinos are not visible because the media doesn't represent them. What the contribution I wanted to make to that is to understand the very intentional ways our contributions are made invisible, and the very real opportunities you have here to make yourselves aware. So there are a lot of things that we don't know, and the origins of why we don't know is not necessarily our fault, but for us to continue not to know is our fault. And so to have, I think when I was a student here, the Afro-Latino studies track did not exist formally. Dr. Hernandez Cuevas helped me create that for myself, as something that I was interested in studying. Between the Spanish program and the history department, it was something that they really encouraged me to do here. So those of you who are students here, take advantage of the professors that are here that are willing to help you think about new ways and new things that you are interested in studying, courses that may not already be available or may not exist on the books, but that will allow you to kind of think outside of what has already been presented to you.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you for the invitation. It feels big privilege. It's a big privilege to be here and be able to speak on this important topic. So I'm speaking from the perspective of an African man. What I'm gonna say is, in terms of policy, we have to start thinking about what policies need to be changed, what pedagogy needs to be updated. The courses that are being taught are concrete ways that we can challenge the concept of being so-called invisible. Even at the college level, Spanish itself needs to be updated to be able to include the perspective of Africans and the reality of Africans as we lived it in the Americas and the Caribbean, etc. We have to form alliances with educators that are responsible for putting pressure on tertiary education systems. We need to form alliances with politicians that are actively engaged in social justice movements to ensure that the voice of the African that lives south of the border is being part of that narrative. We need to also challenge the legal systems that are fighting for reparations to ensure that the voice of the African and the injustices that have been perpetuated towards Africans south of the border are part of the narrative. And as we do that, we will continue to elevate our collective consciousness to know that we are one people that came from Africa, and it was one boat that had many different stops, and we will continue to grow in that consciousness.
So the next question is, do you feel that there are many Afro-Latinos aware of the African descent, but try not to claim it?
Well, since I didn't talk in the last question, I guess I'll speak to this. I've had a chance to travel around in Latin America and the Caribbean, and I'll speak particularly from the perspective of Costa Rica. And in Costa Rica, there is a very vibrant Black community that are descendants primarily of Jamaica. And in that community, there's a strong awareness, and there's a strong, but the way that it occurs in Costa Rica is that the people would more align themselves with their Blackness than their sort of Latino-ness. And so there's sort of this dichotomy there where you see Black people who speak Spanish, and they have a really rich story where there was one period of time where there was a generation of people who didn't speak Spanish. And so it's this very powerful imagery when you go there where you see the grandmothers that only spoke English, and then the children that only spoke Spanish, because there was a conscious effort by the government to stop the people from speaking English. There's a recognition of Blackness in Costa Rica in a way that maybe there might not be in some of the other places, because there's such a vibrant community sort of in the South. And if any of you have been there, you're very familiar with the law.
So Afro-Latinos and in Bayo, that they're Afro-descendants?
But they deny it, basically.
So can we kill the word Latino for the night? Just like, we need to get it out of the way. And use Afro-descendants and Africans. Because if you know that, then you know. Any Panamanians in the room? Ay, ya, muy bien, bienvenida. So in Panama, you know you're black. There's no getting around it. You know it. You live that way. May it be in the overall country context. I'm from Colón, so if you're from Colón, you know you're black. I'm of Congo, so the original Africans that came, the Maroons. I'm also Afro-Caribbean of my grandparents from Jamaica, Barbados, and Martinique, who were construction workers of the canal. So I think it's about how you are raised, how you are taught, how you are told your story. Because one of the things is, no matter how light you came out, you were still a person of African descent. What happens here in the US is the colorism piece and this sort of black-brown thing that they do. I'm black over here and over here. So the brown thing is something that I think continues to perpetrate that division or that lack of understanding of blackness and Africanness. Of who we are. So I think if you have been told that you can pass, then you're gonna pass. And this country puts you in that position to pass, and most of our Latin American countries too. If you can pass that you have more European than African, you're gonna jump at it. So when we start to move past the color of skin and go deeper into our roots, then we can begin to create more consciousness of who we are and what we come from. So I think it has to start from some basic understanding of, like Damani said, we got on a boat, we were dropped off everywhere, lynching happened everywhere, segregation happened everywhere. When we have those basic understanding of our history, then hopefully some of us will step into the light and arrive to our consciousness of who we really are.
In Uruguay, yes, now I think that there is more conscious. There is Afro-Latino activists are part of the politics, so they brought things like affirmative action. We didn't have any affirmative actions at all a few years ago, and now we have. And also the candombe. So candombe is the music, traditional music in Uruguay, coming from African roots. And candombe became national music and is played by everybody. Most of the candombe players right now are white. And I say white because we are Latino, there is no white. Now, even though they think they are, when you go to Europe, any European country, they let you know very clear that you are not. They are white. You are from something different. Anyway, but the conscience is much better now than it used to be during my childhood and adulthood. So it's pretty good.
I think I'll answer this question by way of a story, but a story about how people perceive me moving through different Latin American countries. So again, I think obviously folks know that they are African. I agree that when you are, they also know what it means to identify as African, and places where to identify as African means that you are less than in relationship to the society. So yes, people will pass more frequently than not when they have the opportunity to, and that means more access to education and jobs and have better housing, whatever that means. But what I will say is that this question is what got me interested in studying people of African descent in Spanish-speaking countries in particular. But like my experience, so I spent, the first time I traveled abroad, I went to Cuernavaca, and I had all these experiences where people were like asking me to touch my skin, right? But at the time, none of them felt particularly like isolated to me. Like it didn't really feel to me at the time that people were othering me. Like the family that I lived with, the child, it seemed like genuine curiosity. Then, oh, and also, so when I was in Mexico, I had twits. People would often ask me if I was Jamaican or Cuban. So the assumption there is that African descended people, black people who are in Mexico, are there by way of Jamaica or Cuba. When I was in the Dominican Republic, if anybody knows anything about the DR, I had a horrific experience. I was starting locks. My hair pretty much looked like this all over. And there was no way I could be anything other than Haitian. Like just anything other than Haitian. And that is even for African descended Dominicans who were darker than me. Who were darker than me. If I could not identify as Taino, then the only other thing available to me was to be Haitian. And even if I was born in the United States, my grandmother was Haitian. But then my experience in Venezuela was very different. In Venezuela, also because I got to go there at a time when there was intentional consciousness raising about identity. And that's the other thing, right? Identity is social and cultural. Like, you don't identify in a vacuum. So to be able to identify as a person of African descent, I saw folks who in terms of skin color ran the gamut of what we understand to be black in the United States, as light, as dark, as whatever. And I think that's largely a product of a social movement to get people to identify differently. But still, so people of African descent in Venezuela would see me as Afro-Venezuelan until I opened my mouth and they were like, oh, you have this English speaking thing going on with your Spanish, so you're probably not here, but until you open your mouth, I never would have known. But then other people assumed that I was from Trinidad, Aruba, right? And so what I take from those experiences is that in most places, I was read as a black person who couldn't be from the United States, who also couldn't be from wherever I was. I had to be black and in that space by a route of some other place where black people come from. And so to me, that was always very interesting every time I traveled to kind of understand where in the national imagination black people came from. And to me, that also meant that people weren't reading African descended peoples as like contributors to the nation, to the ways in which the nations were founded. And so for me, that question about identity and visibility is both an intimately personal one, but it's also, we also know that, again, you don't identify in a vacuum. You identify based on how you are seen in relationship to other people and the negative ways in which Africanness, African descendedness is read globally is what contributes to people opting out when it's available to them to opt out.
So to emphasize and definitely compliment what the speakers indicated before me, in Latin America and the Caribbean, there's certainly a huge array of African preservations. The African retention geographically in those places sometimes rivals, if not exceeds, you know, what we've seen in the Gullah Geechee culture, you know, here in the US, in other pockets here in North America. I mean, we got the Garifuna people, we have religious retentions, like candomblé, santería, voodoo. So certainly there is a huge amount of evidence that we are unapologetically African. And I'm not gonna talk about that. I'm gonna talk about the fact that there is a huge amount of denial in terms of our being African, that a huge portion of the population is afraid to be African. And why? There's a lot of confusion. Now we can get into the social cultural aspects of the confusion that exists between nationality and race. Language and race. I'm speaking to you in English, that does not make me an English man, right? But when you go out speaking Spanish, you go up thinking, okay, you know, well, you know, I'm Spanish, and then you come and you immigrate, you know, to the United States, and they call you Spanish because you're speaking Spanish, and then you get confused into thinking that you're Spanish or a Spaniard until you go to Spain, right? That's a big difference between a language and a nationality. Nationality is very convenient in a time of calamity. I mean, here it was very convenient for us during 9/11, World War I, World War II, Vietnam, or we were all American then, right? But the moment that these calamities end, then you get to being black folk, right? So nationality also tends to confuse the process. We start to pay too much attention on a flag and less on our African heritage. So then we become Haitian, we become Puerto Rican, we become Colombian, we become Panamanian, right? And then we overcompensate because we just hate the idea of our culture being or stemming from terms like slave route, slave trade, slave this, slave that, you know, versus a proud people that helped to develop world cultures, world civilizations that were captured and enslaved and held in captivity while they were brought here and robbed of a rich culture, robbed of rich languages, subverted, right? So because we don't have these narratives in education, young babies grow up to be ashamed of who they are. When they turn on the TV and they see a telenovela and they see that constantly that the sister that raised, the woman that raised and gave birth to them is being represented as a servant, right? And you know, that's part of the reason. So I'm not gonna sit here and pretend like it doesn't exist. And I don't want you to call me a liar when you go to our countries and actually see folks that will say, you know, well, no, I'm not like you. I'm not black, you're black, I'm Puerto Rican, right? Or I'm not like you, I'm not black, I'm, you know, light brown, halfway brown, going on tan, you know, you're black, right? So you will encounter that, and it's no different than the process of miseducation that we have encountered and continue to encounter here.
So next question for ARAAC, basically. Whose idea was to start ARAAC?
You want to go first? Actually, ARAAC was started in different countries. There was a meeting in Colombia, and then there was a meeting in Cuba, a meeting in Venezuela, and then, was it 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago?
Yes.
We had our first meeting here in the U.S. where Dr. Hernandez Cuevas, Damani, and I are one of the originals who came together to start ARAAC. And it's ARAAC is Articulación, but we're calling it a regional council of people of African descent from Latin America and the Caribbean. And it's basically an African think tank that is going to be focusing on Latin America and the Caribbean. But Damani, you have our points.
Yes.
I'm gonna pass it over to him and then he'll send it back to me on bringing in why the decade of people of African descent fits into ARAAC.
Yeah, and the context, obviously the historical context, I just spoke about it, so it's a response to some of the realities that we're facing in the respective geographies within Latin America and the Caribbean specifically. One, the first point is to fight against racism, discrimination, xenophobia, and all other forms of oppression that relate to African people in these geographies. To encourage partnerships with educators, with policymakers, with the social justice movements, so that we can work together to fight said oppression, to support and to be in solidarity with other social justice movements within these geographies. So to bring forth the fact that, you know, not only are we being killed here through police brutality, but that's happening at consistent and alarming rates in Brazil, Haiti, Dominican Republic, wherever you see black faces, you know, we are fighting against some of the same evil forces that are trying to suppress us. So we need to be in solidarity with these populations and bring forward that narrative. To promote networks with other organizations that do identify themselves and dare to be African and also part of Latin America and the Caribbean. And we're forming these networks and not, you know, through social media and bringing social media into the fold as well to create a collective identity that restores our presence, our contribution in the realm of history, in the realm of languages. I have to really point out to the work of Dr. Hernandez, who is really pioneering. I can't really think of too many people in North America right now that are deliberately and aggressively and unapologetically saying, we need to decolonize the study of language from this illusion that it stems from Spain, that we need to include who we are, our contributions as Africans, into the richness of this language. And not only Africans, but also non-Europeans. You know, a huge percentage of the language is actually made up of Arabic. You know, most of the words in A start, you know, come from Saudi Arabia, just as an example. So I have to commend Dr. Hernandez for pioneering, and I'm hoping that other colleagues throughout the U.S. will be courageous enough to lead in his footsteps. Telling our stories. So we need to aggressively tell our stories, and also we need to include the struggles of African people in Latin America and the Caribbean in terms of policy making. So not only just speaking, but also what, you know, the movement of reparations, Congress people and these respective governments, so that we're actually implementing policies. And incidentally, one of our co-founders is a brother from Venezuela. He's an ambassador to Venezuela that has done a tremendous amount of work.
Por favor, que quiero.